So yesterday when we talked about climate science and climate change, we showed various data that go back many million years, many hundreds of thousands of years, and also 1,000 years. So I briefly mentioned that there are ways in which we can infer past data. So obviously there were no thermometers which were measuring temperatures in the past, which means we use some indicator which is able to be converted to a temperature, usually not an absolute scale, so it will not be like 29 degrees centigrade, but it will be a change with respect to some reference. So how do we do that? There are a large number of so-called proxies that are indicators of change either in temperature, humidity, ice volume, sea level, and so on. So we'll look at some of these examples. It's very heavy in chemistry, but you can step by step follow the processes and then catch up with the chemistry later on. So let's start with the first one, where we are looking at the one of the most widely used proxy, and it is called a paleo proxy. All these things are typically called paleo proxies because paleo climate means past climate. How far back in the past we have to go? Let's assume you have to go beyond the instrumental period, which is a few hundred years. So when we go a few hundred years back, we begin to call it as paleo climate. And as we go forward, we will see various time scales at which these changes are happening. So the sediments are essentially deposits into water bodies. It could be a lake, it could be a inland sea, or it could be the real ocean, like the Pacific, Atlantic, and Indian Oceans. So we have various processes that bring in sediments, right? When the rivers are flowing into the lakes, seas, or the oceans, lots of material is brought in as sediments from the rivers. They are products of weathering of various rocks. They are organic matter from the forests or grasslands over which they are running, and they could even be agricultural products and so on. So as the rates of flow change or as the material changes, they indicate various quantities of change in climate variables. It could be temperature change, it could be the change in the amount of rain, and so on. So essentially, all sediments are keeping some record of some climate variable. One of the most common ones in these water bodies is also that there is photosynthesis and biology. There are photosynthetic algae in the water, as we'll see a little bit later on. And as they are eaten or they die, they also fall to the bottom of the ocean. And they also keep some signature because photosynthetic organisms or the zooplankton. So photosynthetic organisms are phytoplankton. They are photosynthesizers. They use light, which is phyto. Plankton means planktos, which drift. And zooplankton are those that are eating the phytoplankton or other little larvae and so on. So they all have certain chemical signatures. What gets preserved depends on whether it's a hard shell material, if it's a soft tissue that obviously gets dissolved. So what is preserved in the sediment has to be connected to what it is recording when it is forming, wherever it is forming in the water column. So these are essentially the sediment archives, and the time scales will differ, as we'll see from some examples. So if we look at some examples of living phytoplankton, they include diatoms, which have silica cells, they have coccolithophorids. If you don't understand the names, you don't have to worry, you can look them up, you can Google them. So coccolithophorids have calcium carbonate shells, and these shells, when they're in the surface, they don't dissolve because the waters are super saturated with either silica or calcium carbonate. But when they die and they drop deeper into the water, the acidity of the water or the amount of carbon dioxide in the water increases, and that tends to dissolve the shells. But once they get past the dissolution, if it manages to reach the bottom, then it will get preserved there over time. So layers and layers of these preserved material get stacked up. And these are mostly the zooplankton. A lot of the phytoplankton that have soft shells obviously disappear, but sometimes there are certain organic matter somehow preserved because they got buried before they got eaten up by bacteria, and they are in the sediment where there is no oxygen, so there is no anaerobic respiration that happens in those waters, then they might also get preserved. So you might get organic chains like what are called alkenones, which also relate to temperature and other variables. So here is an example of the clumps of coccolithophorids on the left side, and below that you have diatoms. There are slight differences in the material that forms the shell. This is calcium carbonate. This is formed with silica. So calcium carbonate has lots of details. It has two crystal structures, aragonite and calcite, and depending on the temperature, the calcium tends to get replaced by magnesium or strontium and so on. So if you measure the calcium carbonate and look at the amount of magnesium or strontium, that might tell us how the temperature changed when these shells got formed. So you need two things. You need to figure out when the shells got formed and at what temperature they got formed. So there are various dating techniques which depend on isotopes, as we will see in a minute. Okay, so this is the essential concept, the science behind the paleoproxies from sediment cores. So here is the distribution of near coast and open ocean sediment distribution in the world ocean. You can see that the Pacific, the big ocean, has lots of abyssal clay material, so it could be brought in by aeolian dust that's being carried by winds. Aeolian means winds, airborne, and it's distributed pretty much all over the open oceans. But near the coast, you can see that there are siliceous ooze that are related to diatoms or radiolarians. These are types of phytoplankton or zooplankton. And there is a relation between where the production and photosynthesis happens. So you can imagine that where there is more photosynthesis, there is more food, so there will be more zooplankton in those regions. And it turns out that along the coasts and along the equator, there are reasons why there is more production, whereas when you go into the open ocean, there are reasons why the production is much lower. And you can also see the difference between the Pacific Ocean and the Atlantic Ocean and the Indian Ocean. We briefly saw the circulation yesterday, and that corresponds to the differences in the phytoplankton population, zooplankton population, sediment distribution, and the constitution of the sediments. So it's not just temperature and other variables that are preserved, but also some indicators of circulation. So if you take a core in the middle here, and it's, let's say, recording about 100,000 years, and suddenly there are years where there is more zooplankton in the middle of the ocean, then you have to figure out why the production or productivity went up in the middle of the ocean. So you have to always track all the signatures that are being maintained in these sediments. A great example is here showing a sediment core that is going back to the Cretaceous and Tertiary boundary. Why is that important? Because that's when the well-known meteorite strike happened. And the theory of a meteorite strike, as you may know, came out of the Alvarez brothers finding a very high concentration of iridium in a mountain in Italy, Gubbio. And they said this corresponds to the time when the dinosaurs went extinct. And iridium is not available in such large quantities in a natural setting on Earth. And if there's a sudden burst in concentration, then it must be related to some extraterrestrial source. So they hypothesized that it was a meteorite strike. And then you had to go look for evidence of where this meteorite would have struck. So after a lot of searching, the Yucatan Peninsula in the Gulf of Mexico is where the sediment showed the evidence of the so-called KT boundary. There is a reason why Cretaceous Tertiary is referred to as KT, because there is another CT boundary before, which we won't get into. So this is one exciting way in which sediments are used, for example. But you can also see that there are kind of striations in these sediments, layers. So each year, the sediments fall down, more sediment falls on top, so layers are formed. How many layers get formed in how many years depends on how much sediment is being produced. If it's biologically very productive, like these green colors along the upwelling region and the coastal regions, the biological sedimentation rates will be high. But in regions where you don't see such green colors, biological production is not necessarily zero, but it's just that 1 centimeter may form here in about 10 years, 1 centimeter of sediment layer, whereas in these regions, it might take 100 years or even 1,000 years to form 1 centimeter of a sediment layer. So all those kinds of details are buried in there. We'll come back to the more details of the chemicals that are looked at in the what's in the sediments, other than just counting the layers and timing the when the sedimentation happened in the sediment core. So these are all the lake cores that have been taken. So in the lakes, you can typically estimate the levels of lakes, which corresponds to, for example, the building of glaciers, in which case you are taking water out of the ocean and the lakes and putting it into the glaciers, so the lake level drops, or the melting of the glaciers when the water that was trapped in the glacier is being released back into the lakes or the oceans. So there are indicators of lake level changes, which then can correspond to past climates that where glaciers were building or melting. And they can also have lots of pollen buried in them. So the pollen gives you an indication of what kind of vegetation existed at the time that sediment layer got formed. The distribution of vegetation tells you a lot about the climate. If tropical vegetation is expanding to higher latitudes, which means temperature would have gone up, and the species that are typically found now in the warm tropical climate may have expanded into higher latitudes, or colder species like pines and so on may have come further south because glaciation happened and temperature cooled down and so on. So pollen provide great evidence of past climate changes as well. There's been a long-running multinational, international sediment core drilling program. A ship goes in, it has kilometers long of a drill that goes down into the bottom of the ocean. They drill into the sediments and carefully extract it. And these are all the regions where lots of sediment cores have been already taken, but this program still continues and sediment cores are still being taken. So some scientific question would be there in the mind of scientists when they pick locations for taking sediment cores. So you can imagine that in the Atlantic, you would want to see how the thermohaline circulation has changed over time, and those kind of signatures you want to find in the sediments, or how the monsoon has changed over the Indian Ocean, Arabian Sea, and so on. And taking as many cores as possible all around the world tells you whether changes you see in one location was very local, or if it was actually happening all over the world. So you want to see the evidences, whether it's a global change or a local change. So that's kind of a longer introduction to sediment cores. The other evidences we get, things like the wind-blown loess. So when, for example, glaciation happens, and typically it's very cold, and remember, cold temperatures means less humidity, drier air, which means typically less rain, which means more dust. And for the reasons when glaciation happens, the equator to pole temperature gradient also changes. So the winds tend to get stronger and more dust is blown further away. So this fine silt that gets blown is called loess. And China, for example, has huge mounds of loess. And those loess mountains, you can drill into them and also look at the layers and other chemical evidences to figure out past climates. So you can see the other major evidence that people collect are the ice cores, corals, and tree rings. Ice cores are similar to sediment cores. When snow falls, first of all, I hope you all have some understanding of how glaciers form, okay? Sea ice is on the ocean and it's the freezing of the water, right? So you cannot build sea ice to be very thick for various reasons, which we will learn later on. But on land, glaciers build basically because snow falls on land, it's too cold, so it doesn't melt when the summer comes. The next year, more snow falls on top and it keeps getting compressed and eventually becomes ice called glacier, which is like molasses, so it can actually flow, it's viscous, and it can keep building. So on land, you can build several kilometers thick ice. Okay, so we'll see what kind of feedbacks allow this glacier to keep growing and growing. So you can go then into these glaciers and drill cores just like you would drill at the bottom of the ocean and get evidences. When snow falls and compresses, it's going to take various evidences, even bubbles of air from the time, and keep some signatures of the dust, the pollen, the carbon dioxide in the air, methane in the air, nitrous oxide in the air, and other chemicals that are useful for interpreting past climate. So all that information is buried in the ice core. So depending on how deep the glacier is, you can get pretty long time series of past climate information from those things. One thing I should mention here, that the ocean sediment cores can only go back about 200 million years because the ocean crust constantly keeps reforming. So over the last 200 million years, the ocean floor has been completely renovated. So you don't find sediment cores that are older than about 200 million years. That matters because to interpret the climate before that, you will need to find other evidences. So, less ice cores directly containing information, for example, increased dust typically means colder climates, drier climates, glaciation. Pollen means changes in vegetation. The changes in atmospheric carbon dioxide and methane concentrations can be directly embedded into the bubbles that are trapped when the glaciers form, and so on and so forth. Corals, they are formed of calcium carbonate, but they are always in warmer waters and close to the surface. There are also cold water corals, but they are not reef building corals. Okay? So typically we end up using warm reef building corals, which is actually an animal, and it hosts a lot of symbiotic life, which gives it color and so on. We won't go into the detail, but the chemicals, calcium carbonate with which it forms, also records information about the salt content or the salinity of the water, the sea level of the water, and temperature of the water when the coral is building. So corals can survive for many centuries, but what happens is a coral that was growing at some time in the past, let's say a million years ago, when sea level changes, it might die because it's not in the water anymore. Let's say sea level dropped and it got exposed to the atmosphere. So it will die, but it can still be fossilized and still retain the information from that time. So it's not a continuous time series going back from the present to 1 million years ago, but it is a slice of climate variability from 1 million years ago, and the corals may have lived for a few thousand years. So you get few thousand years of climate information from 1 million years ago. So you have to date the coral to say it's 1 million years old, and then look at the chemical information that's fossilized in it to say how the temperature, sea level, salinity, etc. may have varied a million years ago. Tree rings, as trees grow, each year they form rings, and the width of the ring and the thickness of the ring depends on amount of rain, temperature, because photosynthesis and growth rates are typically affected by amount of precipitation and temperature. And within a year, they can basically record seasonal changes. So tropical regions, for example, don't have a strong seasonal change. So the tree rings will not give you much useful information because the rings will not be changing very much. Whereas if you go to higher latitudes where the summers can get very warm and the winters can get very cold, then the tree rings record excellent changes in tree rings by seasons, and they can serve as very good proxies for past climate and precipitation and so on. So all these proxies, you have to calibrate them against some standard, and you make an assumption called the uniformitarian principle, which means you assume that the processes that are controlling the growth of the corals or the tree rings and ice formation, etc., also happened the same way in the past. Okay, this is a big assumption, but usually it has worked based on multiple proxies being compared with each other and so on. So for all practical reasons, the same kinds of processes have happened over time, and similar information is being recorded over time. So tree rings need seasonal contrast, but as you can see, over the monsoon region, there is a very strong seasonal change. So you can get tree rings in the monsoon region, which can give you good information about climate change over the past. More recently, we have started making instrumental measurements. There are many examples of historic records of wind changes, for example, all the ritus in monsoon and so on. They're basically observed changes of monsoon rainfall within a season. And there are also records of sunspot changes, there are records of astronomical observations from old cultures from India, Egypt, and Persia, and so on. And more recently, we have been recording temperature records from thermometers, rainfall records from rain gauges or buckets, and so on and so forth. In the past 50 to 60, 70 years, we have started building satellites and launching them into space. There are various orbits you can choose, depending on whether you want to watch the same region all day long or you want to go around the world and observe the whole world during the orbit and so on. So now satellites can measure humidity, temperature, winds, chlorophyll, ozone, carbon dioxide, sea level change, and so on and so forth. So satellites have now become a very key part of tracking changes and looking at variability. What are the other exciting proxies for the past climate? So this is a very beautiful figure of a cave. Inside the cave, you have obviously heard of stalagmites and stalactites, ceiling and ground, but there are also others like draperies, column, flowstone, straws, and so on. What are these things? These are basically also things like calcium carbonate. How are they being formed? Essentially, there is rain above the cave. The rainwater seeps into the ground and begins to drip into the cave. So as this process happens, the amount of rain, the temperature of the rain, and various chemicals in the water are being recorded into these so-called speleothems. Okay, so for example, uranium, which is soluble in water, is coming down through these groundwater droplets, and uranium is unstable, so it decays into thorium, but thorium itself is the daughter isotope, but it's also unstable and it's not soluble in water. So if you look at the ratio of uranium and thorium when they reach equilibrium, that kind of gives you a sense of the temperature. So when we talked about calcium carbonate in the ocean, in the corals or in the phytoplankton and zooplankton, they are recording either calcium carbonate temperatures or magnesium strontium that replaced calcium based on the temperature when the shell formed. Here you are using other things like uranium and thorium and so on. So there is very detailed chemistry involved there, lots of calibration issues. You have to be sure of how much uncertainty there is. If you use such a paleo proxy and say the temperature change was 4 degrees centigrade compared to the present, then you should know how much uncertainty there is in this 4 degrees. Is it plus minus 1 degree? Is it plus minus 2 degrees? And so on and so forth. Lots of calibration work goes on behind the scenes that we are not getting into. So by now you got a good sense that isotopes play a big role in keeping these chemical signatures buried into these shells and corals and speleothems and so on. Just to recap, I'm sure you're already exposed to it, learned it, or maybe even teaching it since you're teachers. You start with number of radioactive isotopes in a sample. Let's say you have 100% of the parent isotope and zero amount of the daughter isotope. So you are in a sample which has some stable isotopes and some radioactive isotopes. So over time, the parent isotopes, which is isotope which is radioactive, begins to decay, which means the amount of the daughter isotope begins to increase. When the ratio becomes 1, or the quantity decayed to 50% and the daughter isotope increased to 50%, that is called half-life. That is when the parent isotope became half and the daughter isotope grew to half. So then what is critical is how long is this half-life. So longer the half-life, longer the time scale you can use it for going back in time. Okay, let's look at some examples. So here it is. The radioactive decay used to date climate records include rubidium, which goes to strontium, has a half-life of 47 billion years. So if you want to have a sample of rubidium strontium that has sufficient amount of parent and daughter isotopes to date the climate record, then it's useful for about 100 million years, and it's useful for dating granites, for example. So you can take granites from various places, look at rubidium strontium in those records, and date them back to about 100 million years. There is two types of uranium, 238 and 235, which decay into lead 206 and 207, which has half-life of 4.5 billion years, and this is found in many, many rocks. And both of these are good for more than 100 million years. Potassium to argon, good for more than 100,000 years, found in basalts. Thorium, radon, carbon, nitrogen, we will look at this in a bit more detail in a minute, which is much shorter but serves very well for the climate records over the last 50,000 years. Okay, how is carbon-14 formed? We will see that in a minute. So let's look at some processes that isotopes are used in, or they occur in a natural setting. So we said water is very important in a climate system, correct? So water is what? H2O. We have learned this all our life, H2O. But oxygen, which has 8 protons and 8 neutrons, can actually have more number of neutrons. So there is the most common form, which is O16, but there is also oxygen form O17, and there is an oxygen form that is O18. So instead of having 8 neutrons, it has 10 neutrons, and it is available naturally in the setting. So you, when you say H2O, H2O consists of H2O16 and H2O18. Why is this important? Essentially, if you are evaporating water from a water body like this, then the wind has to pick up the water, it has to rip it off from the water molecules, which are connected to each other with hydrogen bonds, which takes energy. So the energy is being taken out of the water, which is why the water cools when there is evaporation. But this energy required to lift it obviously prefers to pick up O16 because that is lighter, which means when evaporation happens, the evaporated water contains more H2O16 than H2O18. This is called fractionation. So you have taken a certain mix of H2O, which has a certain amount of H2O16 and H2O18, and by the process of evaporation, you have fractionated into more O16 than O18. So typically the evaporation, let's say, happens in low latitudes. The air is being carried poleward by the branch of the Hadley cell that you remember, that is rising in the atmosphere in the tropics and going towards the poles. As it's going towards the pole, it is raining along the way, right? So when it rains, O16 is lighter and O18 is heavier, so O18 falls preferentially more than O16. So you had already picked up less O18 because it's heavier, and now you're going to rain out more O18 because it's heavier. So by the time you reach the higher latitudes like top of the mountain or the polar regions to drop snow, which is going to accumulate and build into a glacier, then you have heavily depleted it out of O18, which means as the glacier builds, it is becoming more and more enriched in O16 and more depleted in O18. On the other hand, if you keep building more and more glacier, you are locking up more and more of the O16 water and leaving behind more and more of the O18 in the ocean, right? So that means if you measure the O18 of the deep water in the past, if it is heavily concentrated in O18 compared to some standard, let's say modern time H2O, then that would mean that maybe more glaciers were built because more O18 has been left behind, and vice versa. If glaciers had melted away and it was warm climate, then O18 would be much less, relatively speaking, to the standard. So that's how you define it. Here is a simple formula for it. Delta O18, this is a measure of deviation from the standard. So you look at the ratio of delta O18 to O18 to O16 in a standard sample that is measured and kept very carefully in a lab somewhere. This is the standard that is kept somewhere. The sample is where you are collecting it, either from the sediment core, from the coral, from ice core or whatever. So that sample is compared against the standard and it's multiplied by 1,000 to express it as parts per mil or parts per 1,000. So when we have 10 on either side of this slanted line, we call it percentage, whereas if you add another zero, it's instead of parts per 100, it's now parts per 1,000, PPT or parts per mil, okay? So that's a very quick and simple explanation of how O18 works. There are complicating factors because temperature has an effect on it in addition to just the formation of glaciers and so on. So all sorts of calibrations are needed when we do this. How does it work? So if you look now at a section going from the equator to the poles, let's say in the tropics you have no deviation, delta O18 is zero. As you go to higher latitudes, you are going to have certain depletion of O18 just because you have taken less O18 here and you are raining out on this side, and you are taking it further and removing more O18 along the way. So the snow that falls here is going to be much more depleted. So delta O18 is getting more and more negative as you go towards higher latitudes. Okay, so it's always a relative scale, it's not an absolute scale. You compare it to some standard and say, is it more depleted in delta O18 or is it less depleted in delta O18? And that tells you whether the climate was colder, more glaciers were forming, or less glaciers were forming. Here is a nice picture of how the ice cores are taken. This is a cave that is dug into the thick glacier that's there in Antarctica. Cores are also collected from mountains like Himalayas, from Greenland, or anywhere you can find glaciers, you can take cores. And the cores look like this. They are kept in very cold, freezing labs. If you are in India, you can go to the NCOAOR, National Center for Antarctic Ocean Research in Goa. They have a core lab. You have to wear special suits to go in because it's so cold, and you can see that there are layers in the core and there are changes in the color. So the chemical constitution changes, amount of dust changes, and so on and so forth. So all kinds of incredibly, in fact, this is referred to as a time machine by Richard Alley, the most famous glaciologist on the planet. Very cute term for it, right? So this is the kind of data you can get from ice core. This is gotten from the Vostok ice core in Antarctica, and you can see we looked at it already. So here it is showing the changes in solar radiation. So we haven't looked in carefully at the changes in radiation due to changes in obliquity, ellipticity, and precession. But nonetheless, we can compute this very easily, as we will see later. And it's showing here the change in delta O18 of the atmosphere. Okay, you can directly measure methane because it's trapped in the bubbles. You can measure the CO2 is up here, and the red line here is showing the temperature. So the temperature is not directly thermometric temperature. It is the change relative to the present climate inferred from isotopes like delta O18. Okay, that's something you have to remember. Various other kind of paleo proxies, the glacial ice, we already mentioned. Valves are something that are formed in lakes where the river flow brings in different amounts of organic matter depending on the season, the photosynthetic season versus the dry season, and these layered sediments are formed that are called valves. Okay, and the tree rings, as we said, the youngest rings are forming as the tree grows, youngest rings are forming outside. It started with the oldest ring at the center. So counting the rings tells you how old the tree is, and looking at the width of the rings tells you something about temperature and precipitation. Coral reefs, as we said, also has layers. The time resolution of these things varies. Remember, as I said, in the ocean sediment core, depending on where you are, the production rate can be very high or very low. So the how well resolved the time scales are depends on that. Corals can record changes on sometimes a weekly time scale. So if you can get 300 years of weekly change, that's a monumental amount of data. So if you are trying to do monsoon changes in the past few hundred years, and you got few hundred years of monsoon data every week, that's, you can do a lot with that in terms of understanding climate variability and change. So this is one of the most exciting fields. If you are trying to excite kids to get into something, geochemistry, biogeochemistry is one of the most interesting field you can get into in the climate science. So we already showed how delta O18 is measured in parts per mil sample. We expressed it slightly differently here, but it's the same formula. Let's look at one more example of delta C13. Just like oxygen has O16, O17, and O18, carbon has C12, C13, and C14. So C12 obviously constitutes almost 99% of the carbon that's there, or 98%. And there are small amounts of C13 and C14. C14 is very different. It's radioactive. We'll come to that in a minute. So just like when evaporation happens, more of the O16 is picked up because O18 is heavier. When photosynthesis happens, plants prefer to take up as much C12 as possible because it is lighter and energetically it's more efficient for them to take up C12. But if carbon dioxide drops in concentration, then they need certain amount of C12, then they will take more C13 because they need the carbon. So they will spend more energy and take more C13. So that means if you can measure the ratio of C13 and C12, then it tells you when C13 is increasing in the organic matter that is preserved in tree ring or old organic matter or whatever, in the sediment cores, for example. That is an indication of change in the amount of CO2 that's available in the atmosphere. Beautiful, right? So you define a similar delta C13 where you are looking at the ratio of C13 to C12 in the sample versus a standard that's preserved somewhere, multiplied by 1,000, and you express it in parts per mil. That's delta C13. Okay, so just like we looked at the delta O18 from the equatorial region to polar region, you can look at C13. So the C13 in the atmosphere on average is depleted at minus 7 parts per mil. as it's photosynthesized, it's fractionated and made more negative in the organic matter because they preferentially take more C12. So the summer grasses, you can see that the trees and shrubs have a different pathway of photosynthesis called C3 because they have three CO2 molecules in the photosynthetic chain. The summer grasses have a different pathway because they evolved at a different temperature and different carbon dioxide concentration. So they have different fractionation. This is critical because as we do global warming and change temperature and the amount of carbon dioxide, it is critical to know who will respond better with higher temperature and higher carbon dioxide. If it turns out, for example, that the summer grasses don't do well, then most of the grasses also include rice, sugarcane, wheat, and so on. So will the crops do well when the carbon dioxide increases and temperature increases? There are a lot of complexities, but I'm just mentioning that we are perturbing the system in such a way that we need to watch out how the vegetation will respond to these changes. So in the ocean also you have photosynthesis. There is inorganic matter and organic matter, the photosynthesized algae and what is coming through the rivers and so on is creating dead organic carbon that's buried in the sediments that we are going to look at for paleoproxies that have a certain resulting fractionation by mixing these various differently fractionated organic carbon. So there is a way to use this fractionation of C13 versus C12 to relate it to the changes in CO2 they would have seen at the time when the photosynthesis happened, when the organic matter got formed. Immediately it should come to your mind that then what is happening to fossil fuel burning? What is fossil fuel? It's old organic carbon. Organic carbon is depleted in C13. So we are taking out organic carbon from the ground from long time ago, which is more depleted in C13 than the average atmospheric concentration, and we are burning it. We're putting it into the atmosphere. Does that mean there is a signature of fossil fuel burning in the atmosphere? Sure there is. We'll see that in the next lecture. See you next time.